Welcome, Summit Church. If you don't know me, I'm Jamie Beer, the online campus pastor, and I am so glad you are connecting with us today. Some of you are getting to know me better, and that is through the church emails. I send them out every week, and usually at the beginning of the emails, I put in some sort of random fact. It usually has to do with a national holiday or an event that happened years ago in history on that weekend. So this last week, I was pretty amazed. I was really interested in what I discovered. And it was 177 years ago, on June 6th, George Williams founded the YMCA. Why is this interesting? He was only 22 years old. He lived in London and he was looking around and he saw in the streets that people were hurting. He saw despair and loneliness. And he's like, I just need to provide an escape for these people. So he just invited 11 of his friends over for a Bible study. And that turned into the YMCA that we know today. Now, they serve thousands of people in 119 countries. And it started with a Bible study. I could do that, you could do that. It's pretty amazing. And I want to introduce you today to our speaker for the month, Pastor Jack Witt. Pastor Jack had a church in Reading that he served for many, many years. And now he's the director of a youth program that helps youth to be encouraged and they coach them so that they can become successful young adults. So let's hear from Pastor Jack.
Hello, Summit Church. I'm very excited to spend the next 4 weeks with you studying the scripture together, exploring what God has to say to us in terms of hope and encouragement and wisdom. I am here filling in very poorly, I'm sure, for your pastors who are taking a needed sabbatical. And I'm excited to be here to share the word of the Lord with you over these weeks, I'm more excited about the opportunity to, in some small way, contribute to Pastor Chris and Lisa's time away, that they would have that time to be able to rejuvenate, to be restored and refreshed, and that's what a sabbatical, professional sabbatical, is really intended to do, is to help people to be able to regain ground, to reset a little bit from the pressures of ministry and whatever their professional job is. So we're happy to be a part of that and contributing to that. You can contribute to that as well by praying for them while they're gone and by being supportive of the other leaders at Summit who are stepping up to take on new responsibilities, enlarged responsibilities, new challenges that they've not faced before. So praying for them and being supportive and responsive to them is going to be a great benefit to the church through these next months. So over the next 4 weeks, I want to dig into an Old Testament book called Nehemiah. And Nehemiah is one of my favorite Old Testament books, mainly because of the way that it's written. It has, other Old Testament books are more historical. So it's somebody telling, it's a second or third party telling a story, sometimes that they were not directly involved in themselves. And so the book of Nehemiah has this, it's like we're reading Nehemiah's diary. He is he's writing day by day the accounts, the things that he's thinking, the things that he's experiencing. He even records his prayers. So we have some really great prayers to be able to look at through this book, through this journal, I guess we could say. And so we're going to spend the next 4 weeks talking about this this great story. Let's kind of set the background, the context for this as we get going on this venture together over the next next 4 weeks. Number one, God had been warning Judah. So this is the southern kingdom of Israel. He'd been warning them over and over again that if you continue to rebel against me, you're going to lose your homes and you're going to lose your freedom. And in fact, he told them the period of time that it would be, so that they would be in captivity, in exile for 70 years. And they persisted in their rebellion, and God allowed the Babylonians to come in under Nebuchadnezzar to ransack the city, to cart the people off, and they destroyed the city. I mean, they toppled the walls, they burned all the gates with fire. It was a complete devastation. So Nehemiah is a Jewish man who's a part of what's called the diaspora. So that's diaspora. This is the people who are displaced as a result. Sometimes it's because of economic hardship. So some people that are coming into this country from other countries where they are facing financial hardship and they're looking for opportunities in America, they would be a part of that group. In most cases, the diaspora is the result of war, where people are trying to escape war. And so Nehemiah is one of those individuals who's been displaced from his homeland. He's living in Persia, and he's serving in a direct role to the king, and we'll read about that. Not only had 70 years passed of the of Judah's exile into Babylon, but an additional 72 years had also transpired. So now when Nehemiah steps into the scene here and he starts to take his role, we're finding that 142 years have passed. So this is not any short period of time. And for all of those years, this city of Jerusalem had lay in waste and in ruins. Ezra, the book just before Nehemiah, is a book about Ezra, who is a priest who comes in prior to, or he precedes Nehemiah, and his job is, or his role was, to help this ragtag group of people who were inhabiting the city of Jerusalem. He's helping them to be able to restore the temple. So they had already done this work, and the temple was rebuilt. They were already offering sacrifices, conducting worship in the temple in Jerusalem by the time that Nehemiah comes onto the scene. Most scholars look at these two figures, Ezra and Nehemiah, as types of God's work in our lives as individuals. Ezra would be the God's work in salvation. So he comes into the sin ruin of our lives, that God steps into that sin ruin of our lives, and he restores the very center, the most important part of us, which is that center of worship, our connection to God. So Ezra had done that. Nehemiah then kind of prefigures or symbolizes the work of the Holy Spirit, that he comes into these sin-wrecked lives. And most of you would agree with me that when you came to profess your faith in Christ and to receive his salvation, there was still a lot of ruin. There were still a lot of broken places in your lives and relationships and things that weren't working just the way that they needed to in order to support your faith. And so the Holy Spirit works his good work in us post-salvation to help us to grow so that our lives are, like the city, needed to be habitable again, needed to be safe, it needed to be defendable. And so the Holy Spirit's doing that work in us today, post our salvation, in the same way that Nehemiah comes in after Ezra, restores the temple, restores that center of worship, and now begins, as we read on through the story, that Nehemiah is going to rebuild the places of habitation, the walls, the place of defense. He's going to make the city habitable again and safe. So let's jump in, and we're going to read the entire first chapter of Nehemiah, and we won't do that from week to week. There's 13 chapters, I think, in the entire book of Nehemiah, so we're not going to read every verse over the next 4 weeks, but we'll just kind of find our way through, draw out particular ideas and concepts of how those things apply to us. And the theme that I'm picking up on for these next 4 weeks with you is talking about following our hearts and planning with our heads. So God gave you not just a heart that is open and responsive to him, but he gave you a head. It gave you the ability to think your way through things, to plan. And Nehemiah is a great example of this, a man who is really driven by his passion, his desire to see the city of Jerusalem restored. But he's also a planner. He's also someone who sets up and organizes a way to be able to do the things that he felt that God was calling him to do. So here we go, reading Nehemiah chapter 1, verse 1. It starts out like this. It says, "These are the memoirs of Nehemiah, the son of Hilkiah, in late autumn, the month of Kislev, in the 20th year of King Artaxerxes' reign, I was at the fortress of Susa. Hanani, one of my brothers, came to visit me with some other men who had just arrived from Judah. I asked them about the Jews who had returned there from captivity and about how things were going in Jerusalem. They said to me, things are not going well for those who returned to the province of Judah. They are in great trouble and disgrace. The wall of Jerusalem has been torn down and the gates have been destroyed by fire. When I heard this, I sat down and wept. In fact, for days I mourned, fasted, and prayed to the God of heaven. My vote for the most overused and misused word of the last decade is this word, passion. People talk about, I have a passion for dogs. Other people say, I have a passion for surfing. There's even organizations, even businesses. I saw a furniture company that said, we're passionate about sofas. Read, there was a prominent university that their slogan is that they are passionate about everything we do. So people throw around this word, they use this word passion all the time. The word passion means this intense, almost uncontrollable emotion. And it used to be reserved, the word passion used to be reserved for soap operas and romance novels. And so you might hear the new Danielle Steele romance novel of, you know, passion on the high seas or something like that. So we've used that word, but it's come into more common use among, as I said, businesses and just everyday individuals talking about their passion. It's also impacted the way that we describe what we do in the church as believers. You'll hear believers all the time say, I have a passion for worship. I have a passion for teaching and helping people to understand God's word. That would be something that maybe I would use to describe what I feel called to do, that I have a passion for that. But it would be hard for us really to, as we think about that, it would be hard for us to use that this strong, almost uncontrollable emotion. How does that apply to floor coverings or to sofas or to educational systems? And really, how does it even apply to the things that we do in the church? So the word is significantly overused. There are a couple things that I'd like to sort out, and some of you are going to say, well, you're just kind of getting tied up in semantics, and perhaps I am, but there are a couple things that we should look at, because Nehemiah responded not to a passion to do something, but he responded to a sense of burden, or he allowed his heart to break over the condition and the situations that the people in Jerusalem were facing. I don't think we could put too much emphasis on the clinical definition or the Webster's dictionary definition of passion. People are always using words in different ways than Webster would define them. But the most common way that people use the word passion is it's in a way to express how very much they like or they love doing this particular thing or that particular thing. When you tell me you have a passion to teach, you're really saying that you love teaching and you get a sense of personal fulfillment in doing that. You love to see the results of what you're doing. You have a great passion about that. When you talk about people who want to help other people understand art or history or spiritual things better, there's nothing wrong with understanding your abilities and finding enjoyment in using them. But you must understand, all of us must understand, that the motivation that God most often uses to engage us in what he wants to do and to bring benefit and help into the lives of others is heartbreak. So sometimes we use passion as a way for us to begin to think about how God fulfills his will in our lives. So my passion then is informing that the thing that I really like doing, I really love worship, or I really love teaching people about scripture or whatever, that is an indicator then of God's will. And in some cases, maybe it is. But the more consistent predictor of God's will is is that he places a need in our view, in our understanding. He makes us aware of something that he's aware of and he wants to address. So the problem with aligning our lives this way is that it puts our passion, and if you think about it, and as I described it, that that's a that passion is a person's personal interest in this is something I care deeply about, this is something that I get enjoyment and I get a sense of meaning and fulfillment from doing. That's kind of self-focused, isn't it? If you really think about it, it puts a lot of attention on the self. And then there's a lot of TV preachers out there who are telling us that God's will is that you're happy and that you're just doing exactly what you're called and you're gifted to do. And that's what makes God the most happy day after day. And but the scripture really aligns us a little bit differently. It says that that God's will has to be preeminent, that's our purpose. And then what he uses to help us understand part of his will is heartbreak. It's this sense of this emotional connection to a need. It's this awareness. As Nehemiah heard this report, he asked these guys, he knew that they had just come from Jerusalem, and he says, hey, how is it going for the people there? What's the condition of the city? And their report about how people were living in shame and disgrace and how that the walls were broken down and just their description of this just unsettled him to the very core of his being. And the scripture says that Nehemiah, he says of himself, he says, and I wept and fasted and prayed for days. So when we put God's will and in alignment with using our heartbreak in order to understand part of what God wants for us to do, there's an old word here that I'll put up that we used to use in the church a lot, and it's called burden. And we don't hear people talk about that so much anymore. But there's a sense when we read Nehemiah that this is not a man who just loved organization. His passion was to organize things and to make things better. And so he started with his closet in his master bedroom last week, and now he wants to work on your living room or your garage. And so his goal is to do this. And so as people find out more about Nehemiah's passion and his ability to organize things, they say, hey, why don't you think about using some of those skills for the needs in Jerusalem? No, it wasn't driven by him, by his own sense of what brings fulfillment to him. And I will say this, that's because God is generous and because he knows us, what he calls us to do to fulfill his will through this heartbreak, through this receiving of a burden, that this is not what I've decided to do or what makes me happy or what I get enjoyment from, but this is something that has been placed in my hands to carry. That God will take the things that we call passion and he will use our talents and our abilities and the things that give us enjoyment in order to fulfill his will. So this is a better alignment for us if we start with passion and then try to synchronize that and say, well, my ability to fulfill the will of the Lord or God's will for my life is based upon me using and doing the things that I really enjoy doing, you may miss out on some of the things that God is actually calling you to do. When I pastored for 25 years, and I don't know how many times I literally in the hundreds of times that I sat down with people and I asked them, I said, we really need your help to do this one particular thing, or we really need you to step up to this. And I don't know how many times or hundreds of times I had people who looked right back at me and said, well, I'm not sure I have a passion for that. So when we align our passions above and let that try to inform God's will for us, we may be missing his will. So there's nothing wrong with understanding your abilities, finding enjoyment by using them and meaning by using them, but you must understand that this primary motivation of God's will that God most often uses to encourage us and to engage us in what he wants to do is through this heartbreak. There's scripture in Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 through 13, and Paul is writing to the church there, and he says, "Dear friends, you always followed my instructions when I was with you, and now that I'm away, it is even more important. Work hard to show the results of your salvation, obeying God with deep reverence and fear." And then I've always loved this 13th verse of Philippians 2. It says, "For God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases him." Spirit-energized work is this internal work that the Holy Spirit's doing in us, is that it's a blessing that God says, "I'm not just going to give you the desire to do something, but I'm going to give you the power." It'd be kind of cruel, wouldn't it, for God to call us to do something and not give us the ability, or to give us the ability and not give us the desire. So this inward work of the Holy Spirit is complete, but there's an object to this desire and this power. What is that object? It is accomplishing what pleases God. So again, we have to get back to this order of things. God's will and God's pleasure are what is at the highest point. When God receives the most glory and enjoyment, when his sons and daughters are seeking his will, are loving the things that he loves, and choosing to love what he loves, and are following and obeying his will. That's where God receives his glory. So accomplishing what pleases God. The word desire in this verse cannot be twisted to mean what we commonly call passion. It means to be inclined toward the things that please God. So what does Nehemiah do when he receives this burden, or when his heart breaks over what he sees going on, or what he's heard now is going on in the city of Jerusalem? He prays. So we'll catch back up in verse 5. It says, "Then I said," so he's just said, "When I heard this, I wept, I prayed, and I fasted for days." And then verse 5, he says, "Then I said," and this is one of his first, or this is his first recorded prayer in his journal. He says, "Then I said, O Lord, God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant of unfailing love with those who love him and obey his commandments, listen to my prayer. Look down and see me praying night and day for your people Israel. I confess that we have sinned against you. Yes, even my own family and I have sinned. We have sinned terribly by not obeying the commands, decrees, and regulations that you gave us through your servant Moses. Please remember what you told your servant Moses. If you are unfaithful to me, I will scatter you among the nations." And now he's talking as one scattered, as one who's recognized that he's been displaced along with a bunch of other people, still a bunch of Israelites that are living in Babylon. And he says, "If you are unfaithful to me, I will scatter you among the nations." But he's reminding the Lord, or he's rehearsing the promise of the Lord. "But if you return to me," he says, "and obey my commands and live by them, then even if you are exiled to the ends of the earth, I will bring you back to the place I've chosen for my name to be honored. The people," verse 10, "you rescued by your great power and strong hand are your servants. O Lord, please hear my prayer. Listen to the prayers of those of us who delight in honoring you. Please grant me success today by making the king favorable to me. Put it into his heart to be kind to me. In those days, I was the king's cupbearer." This prayer has a lot of content, and we don't have the time to explore all of it, but I want to point out just a couple of things that are in the prayer. First of all, he acknowledges that what is happening to the people of Israel, what is taking place is not so much God planned as it is God predicted. So some of you have wondered, it's like, why does God let this stuff happen? Why doesn't God intervene? Or why do things end up the way they do? Did God plan this? And Nehemiah is recognizing that it's not so much that God has planned those things. And he says, "I've set this all up for you." No, God just predicted those things. He set up the arrangements of saying, if you continue to rebel against me, here's the consequence. But if you turn to me, then I'm going to draw you back in from all the places you've been scattered. And that's the hope that he affirms in this prayer. He affirms his hope that what can happen in redemptively in people and places is possible because of God's promises. So, and that's really the hope that you would have. If you're looking around, and what I would encourage you to do as we move through these next 4 weeks together is to think about the kinds of situations that are around you. It's like, if you're not asking about people, then you won't have the opportunity really to be able to have your heart broken, right? So what's going on in your neighborhood? Are you inquiring about people and about situations in your community? I'm a part of a large foster care organization, and our CEO attended a city meeting. The mayor was there and city officials, and they were all talking about this problem of homelessness. And in our community, it's been quite the challenge with that. And as they were describing and talking about the problem with homelessness, someone got up and started quoting statistics about the number of high school students that were in that were classified as homeless. So they're registered in local high schools, but they are classified as homeless. That means they're couch surfing, or they may be living with a parent in like or a guardian. Sometimes they're living with unrelated adults in these week by week or month by month apartments down in the bad section of town. And so when our CEO heard that, it's like something gripped his heart. And he cares about homeless people, but when he heard about teenagers who were enrolled in high school trying to get by, he said, we have to do something. And I remember the day that he met with me and shared it, and I could just tell his heart was broken for this. It just had disturbed him so deeply. And there's some things that you're encountering or you've heard about, needs that you've heard about that have stirred something in your soul. And God is going to use that heartbreak, that burden, in order to reveal his will for you. And so it may be paying attention to that neighbor down the street, or it may be a need in your community that you think about, man, we have to do something about this. So entering into those kinds of projects can be daunting, because it's like sometimes they feel like they're just way larger than what we could ever pull off on our own. But Nehemiah reminds himself in this prayer. He affirms the hope that what could happen if people acted, if people tried to turn things around, that what could happen redemptively in people and places is possible because of God's promise. He says, as much as there's a consequence for you rebelling, if you just return to me, if you just come back, there's going to be, I'm going to gather you back in from, no matter if you're scattered to the ends of the earth, I'm going to draw you back in. And then at the very end of the prayer, Nehemiah asks for something specific. So he says this, he says, grant me success today, God, by making the king favorable to me. Put it into his heart to me, put it into his heart to be kind to me. What that reveals, that specific ask reveals the presence of a plan. So feeling something is never the same as doing something. And we're going to spend some time talking about that over the next couple of weeks. That how do we take action on things? Because there's kind of a psychological, in fact, we'll talk about this a bit next week, is there's almost a psychological benefit or a relief that comes to us by just talking about things that we care about. And but we have to do something about what we feel. Actions are required. And Nehemiah had not just felt something, but that he had started to formulate a plan. He had started to put something together that would set in motion this heartbreak into action. And so this ask reveals the presence of a plan. In the plans and the doing is where your God-shaped abilities, this is the things that we would call our passions, the things that bring meaning, fulfillment, because of being able to be useful in those ways, those are where those things come into alignment. So let's finish up and just talk about just four action steps for this week, or four ways for you to, I'd like for you just to start thinking today about this question. What has kept me up at night? What's been troubling me? What have I heard about a person or about a group of people or about a situation in town or about a school, about a particular group of people? What have I heard that has stuck in my soul, that has stirred up this kind of heartbreak? Then, and God's trying to speak that and to place that into my heart as a burden. Am I paying attention to that? So number one is be concerned about the plight of others and allow your heart to break for them. So one of the best ways you can do that is just start asking questions. I would encourage you this week, start asking questions. People that are missing from your life, people that you're wondering about, that house down the street that the weeds are growing up, and it's like, okay, what's happening there? There's people still living there, but what's going on? So asking about the plight of others. God is most often engaged. What he is asking for us to do involves engaging us, employing us, deploying us to be able to help to serve and meet the needs of others. So be concerned about their plight. Allow your heart to break for them. Number two, affirm God's promises in prayer. So some people say, I'm reminding God. God doesn't need to be reminded, but we do. And so affirming God's promises, when he asks for something, especially if it seems daunting or overwhelming, you'll need to affirm your hope and your trust and belief in God's promises and what he has said. Do that in your prayers. And then the third thing is make a plan for as long as you can see from where you are. The challenge, and we'll talk about this next week, but the challenge for most of us is that we get really, we start trying to forecast what things are going to be, and we're trying to look to the end of the problem or the end of the solution. And it's so big and so gigantic that we don't really plan. We're not planning in small enough chunks to where we're willing to take steps into that area. It's like that Old Testament story. I think it's in Psalm 119, where it talks about the word of the Lord, God's word being a lamp unto my feet. And it really means that there's an illumination. It's like carrying a lantern in a dark place. And there's like a 3 or 4 foot circle around you that's illuminated. And I can see enough to take the next couple of steps. And as I take those steps, I'm carrying that light with me. And so that illuminates the section that I can't see now from where I am. And a lot of us will stay in a really paralyzed, immobilized state because we are trying to plan for things that we can't see. Plan as far as you can see. What's the next couple of steps? What would be the first thing about responding to that neighbor who's maybe in facing some great hardships in their life, and you're feeling the need, the sense of God's hand on your life is burden for you to do something about that. I don't know what the end of that story is going to be. You don't know what that's going to be, but plan for as far as you can see from where you are. And then the last one is pray for success of your next few steps. So Nehemiah prayed this prayer, but he had this very specific request. I'm going to go and I'm going to ask the king for favor. I'm going to ask for him. And he received so much more. As we read through the story, he received so much more than the king's permission just to go and help out in his homeland. He received blessings of supplies and materials and riches. And he, you know, so he received so much more. But he just prayed over what's the next step. It's not the end of the story. It's not the whole plan. I'm just praying, God, give me favor when I'm in front of the king today. Give me favor. So pay attention to what's stirring your heart, what's bringing up burden, what's breaking your heart these days. And let's put some action to that as we go through these next weeks together. Plan with Nehemiah about how to live our lives responsibly to what God wants to do through us and in us for the benefit of others. All right, let's pray. Father, thank you for your goodness to us. Thank you for stories that are recorded in Scripture. I love that we have Nehemiah's diary, and I pray that you would allow these words to speak to us. I pray that people would not be discouraged today by the fact that their desires are the things that make them feel complete or happy or fulfilled. can mislead them away from the things that you have for them. But would you just allow them to sort those things out, to set their own self-interest aside long enough to have you break their hearts for things that are important to you? And we're trusting you through these next weeks to help us to move forward. I just pray for testimonies out of Summit Church, stories after story of people who have taken strides forward on the things that you've stirred in their hearts to do, and that the community is better, that people are healed, that people are blessed and loved better because we have allowed our hearts to break for them, for their needs, and we have used our minds to be able to set ourselves on a plan of action and trusting you to help us to fulfill those steps. So we ask all of this in Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Jack, for that message. This is the part of our services when we get to turn to God with our tithes and with our offerings. Now, like we were talking about today, we need to come to God and we need to look at others through the kind of eyes that He has. He sees the need of others and He's concerned for them. When we bring our tithes and offerings to the church, it goes back into the community and helps other people to know Him more, and it meets their needs. So let's join together now and let's pray as we give our tithes and offerings. Lord, thank you so much for this time that we've had together so far. And I pray that you bless this time and you bless each person who's giving right now. And I pray that you use it for your kingdom to grow. In Jesus' name, amen.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy.
Summit Church, I have some announcements for you. This upcoming week, we have two exciting events happening. The first one is Level Up Sunday. So if you have a student who is going from kindergarten to first grade, fifth to sixth, eighth to ninth, or graduating senior, we want to bless them on Sunday morning. We want to give them a gift and we want to pray over them. So make sure that you contact Heather for elementary kids and that you contact Emily Lautzenheiser for our middle school and high school students. Next thing, we have gear groups starting June 15th. This one's gonna be on prophecy and it's from 6:30 to 8 p.m. on Zoom. So make sure you look into that and you sign up today. We have some exciting events happening this summer at Summit too. We have Summit going to the rink and Summit is going bowling. I just wanna give you guys a heads up so that you can save those dates. The last date I want you to save is from October 8th to 10th and that is when Summit is going to camp. So make sure you mark those on your calendar and you save them so that we can all go to camp together. And it was great spending time with you and we'll see you again next week.